Today, the topic of discussion, what we are going to look at is types of parsers. There are two types of parsers majorly classified into top-down parser, bottom-up parser. In the earlier class also, I have mentioned about it. Now, first we are going to look at the holistic picture. Types of parser, it is majorly categorized into two types, top-down, bottom-up. If we look at top-down, up to this is the portion we may need to look at top-down parser. This portion we need to look at bottom-up parser. The complete understanding of top-down parser you would be doing with your unit number 2. The complete understanding of bottom-up parser you would be doing with unit number 3. However, right now it is mandatory to have holistic picture. Then we can go for deeper understanding of each and every parser and its types. So that is what the message I want to convey through this diagram. I have drawn this picture by looking at various materials and various stuff, and it is a holistic approach I have brought in a single page. So this material also I am sharing in your Google Classroom. Kindly watch it. So best than these, you may not find it in any of the book. So this is a kind of concise compilation. It's a kind of mind map, I can say. Although it looks like a tree, it is a mind map. Let us look at first top-down parser. The name itself says you need to build a tree from the top level. The meaning is root node. You must start with the root node. Then every level of expansion of the tree, what you would be doing is it works on what production to use. You all know that parse tree starts with the root node, subsequently interior node, then it ends with the leaf node. When it reaches the leaf node, it is full of terminals. When it is root node and when it is intermediate node, it is full of non-terminals. While expanding the tree, the major role of the top-down parser is to choose the production. You will have set of production. Among all the production, which production is a suitable production to move towards the string? Ultimately, what I can say is top-down parser will start with start symbol. Already in the previous class also we have seen. It starts with the start symbol and it moves on to the string or yield. Yield is finally leaf. The string which we are harvesting from the tree is called yield. This is the fashion or the type of working nature for the top-down parser. When it comes bottom-up parser, what it does is it starts from the string. Then it moves on towards, I can't put an arrow mark, that is not conventional. It moves on towards the start symbol. Here, reduction is happening. Reduction is what the larger portion is reduced to smaller portion. Reduction is happening. Here, expansion is happening. That is a major thing you may need to be able to understand the difference between these two. So this one line of explanation, if you understood, then that's more than enough. You can sail with these two types of parser easily. So that is a start I wanted to give. A good start to understand these two parser. Now, this top-down parser, otherwise technically called as LL parser. Why they are calling it as LL parser is, always given the input string, the scanning is going to start from the direction left to right. The derivation type which is used, either derivation or tree type, leftmost derivation is used. That is why it is called LL parser. Let us see this. What is bottom-up parser? This is termed as technically LR parser. This first L stands for left to right, as like this only, left to right. This R stands for reverse of rightmost derivation. Understand, reverse of, this is just, whenever during exam, you may pick up like rightmost derivation alone, not at all. Reverse of rightmost derivation. Through example, you can understand much better. Nothing to worry at this point. Just be aware of what I'm trying to tell. Now, here in every step it is focuses on when to reduce. It uses the strategy called reverse of rightmost derivation. It uses the strategy called what production to use next. That's all. This is the preliminary introduction of two types of parser. So you need to have this rough idea about the difference between top down and bottom up parser. Now let us move on to the types of top down parser, types of bottom up parser. Types of top down parser classified into three categories majorly. The first category is backtracking type or brute force method. I will tell you what it is. Second category is recursive descent type. Third category is non-backtracking type. Let us see one by one. What is backtracking? In your analysis of algorithm subject, you would have come across backtracking, a keyword. It is a one type of algorithm. There are majorly five types of algorithms exist. One is backtracking, greedy programming, dynamic programming, and branch and bound. These are all the types of algorithms you would have come across. Among all those algorithms, one of the famous algorithm is backtracking. The moment you use backtracking, it is termed as brute force method. What is brute force method? Let us see. Brute force method uses all the combinations. 1 minute, I'll explain. It will substitute, it will work in the combination order, the process of combination. Exhaustive search. What is the meaning of exhaustive search? All the possible combinations. For example, if any one of you trying for job, you need to do exhaustive search. Where are all the openings? What are all the possible openings available? How can I apply? Where can I apply? You need to sit and do exhaustive search. That exhaustive search is all the available possibilities, avenues, also known as generate and test, is a very general problem technique. This is one of the algorithm paradigm. It enumerates all the possible candidates, systematically enumerates. What's the meaning is, for example, you are having three flavors of chocolate. You need to try all the flavors of chocolate. Whenever you are getting money, you need to buy each and every time the combinations of chocolate. So you will be trying all the available chocolates at your nearby shop when during your childhood. That is one of the best example for exhaustive search or possible combinations. There you will be having only 1 rupee. When you are child, your parents would be giving 1 rupee only. So, but in the shop, you could see 5 different types of chocolate. You may not able to buy it. You are not affordable. So you will try one chocolate one day. At another day, you will try another chocolate. At another day, you will try another chocolate. You are knowingly, unknowingly, you are doing exhaustive search in your life. That is what the brute force method. Nothing more. It's a great combination. It's a technical terminology. Either backtracking be it, or brute force. Both are technical terminology we are using in our day-to-day life. Permutation combination. Even if I go to Karachi biscuit shop, I used to try all the combinations of biscuits whenever I visit. The moment I purchase few types of biscuits, next time I will try other 2-3 types of biscuits. That is called brute force method. All the combinations, trying it out. That's all. Now tell me, what is the drawback? Is it advisable to use brute force method in our computer? Will it work well? Tell me yes or no. Will it work well? Yes or no? You need to answer me yes or no. That's all. I'm not asking more than
no,
that.
No, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank
no,
you.
No, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, ma. Why it is not possible? Exhaustive search, if sits and do, computation time would go. Your resources, what are all the meaning of resources? Your memory, types of memory, and your CPU. All it would consume more. And you are waiting. Nowadays, people are waiting for best or lightweight, optimized, and fastly executed compilers. You know, in 3 years, definitely Python is going to become down. Right now, Python is leading in the second position after JavaScript. I was telling last year and all, it is going to become top first language itself. I was telling it is going to become true also. But after 3 years, it is not going to become true. Julia is the program going to rule. Why Julia is going to rule is the speed of execution. The compiler itself lightweight compared to Python. So the volume of data is going to become tremendous in the forthcoming years, because every business is going to become online. After this COVID, most of the business is coming up with online e-commerce business. Then all the data, how people would able to handle by the time Python may defamed. So that is what I'm trying to tell. These are all the types of algorithms should not be kept in compiler design. Theoretically, you can discuss, I can discuss. That is not an issue. But when it becomes practical, you can't keep backtracking algorithm. That is the explanation for your answer. No, that is fine. Now, second algorithm. Another method is called recursive descent. That is, this algorithm will work recursive manner. You all definitely would be knowing what is recursive algorithm. I will not explain again and again, because you are third year guys. First year itself, I taught the topic called recursion. That is called recursive algorithm. In this scenario, may or may not require backtracking. The moment it says may itself, it won't suitable for practical. It is only for theoretical. Finally, these two algorithms, only 2 mark definitions you are going to learn only in the theoretical aspects. As per your syllabus, only 2 mark question. That's it. Nothing more you need to concentrate. If you know this definition partially, if you able to write in your exam, and this is the algorithm will work recursive manner, and it may or may not require backtracking. That's all you should know. Nothing more. 3-4 sentences if you know, no need to focus on this portion. Where exactly you need to focus is my question. That is non-backtracking algorithm, otherwise called predictive parser, otherwise called LL parser. Don't think that these are all different word. I am telling that this is theoretical terminology. Non-backtracking is purely theoretical. The moment if it becomes practical, or if it is becoming compiler design perspective, then it is said to be predictive parser. Then much more better word, based on the working principle of the parser, it is termed as LL parser. Just now I said first L stands for left to right, next L stands for leftmost derivation. That's it, your choice. You can either use predictive parser in your examination point of view or articulation point of view, or you can use LL parser in your usage point of view. That is your choice. That's all about top-down parser. Non-backtracking, then it is going to become deterministic. Whenever backtracking is available, non-determinism is going to play a role. I will give example for this also, nothing to worry. One example we will discuss here, only small example. Rest all we are going to invest our time on predictive parser either or LL parser, the same meaning. Now, what is the drawback of predictive parser, LL parser or top-down parser? That we should understand. Only then I can move to this portion. Otherwise, there is no meaning. Now, what is the problem we are facing with the top-down parser or predictive parser or LL parser is this parser demands free from ambiguity, free from left recursion, free from left factoring. That all pre-processing we have discussed in the last session. That all it demands. The moment it demands, either the compiler designer or the machine need to work on that pre-processing work. That is costly affair or strainful process. So that people went on to different parsing type, that is called bottom-up parser. Got the point? Top-down parser, what is the problem is no other problem we have. Only that pre-processing 3 tasks we need to invest our time and effort and resources. One is elimination of ambiguity, another one is elimination of left factoring, another one is elimination of left recursion. These are all the topic in the immediate class, previous immediate class we have discussed. So now let us move on to bottom-up parser. Bottom-up parser majorly classified into 2 types, operator precedence parser, shift reduce parser. Operator precedence parser, the working principle, the way we need to design this parser is different. This will work with ambiguity. That is the beauty of this grammar. Whereas shift reduce gram reduce parser will not work with ambiguity. Again, it should work like this. So that shift reduce parser, otherwise called LR parser. Just now we have said L stands for left to right. R stands for reverse of rightmost derivation. That is what we have seen just now. That is LR parser. This LR parser is our main focus of discussion, and operator precedence parser as well in the third unit. Simple LR parser, LR parser, look ahead LR parser, canonical LR parser. When I put in this arrangement, you can understand the power of computation is becoming better and better. This is the least power, or it consumes either more memory or more speed. When it comes this, this becomes better than this. When it comes here, this becomes better than these two. When it comes here, this comes better, much better than these three. That is the meaning of power of computation. With this introduction, let me go on explaining one example for this, and subsequently we are going to look at construction of predictive parser. What are all the preliminary thing we need to do? How we need to do this? The moment we complete this LR parser, unit 2 completed. Then we will be moving on to unit 3. Now I will change the sharing screen because I have prepared it in yet another document. This is in the landscape. So that is in the portrait. So that I couldn't fit in one document, I am keeping here and I am moving on to another document. Could you able to see, guys? Table. This is two table, not a diagram. Anyone could respond me? The change of the document. Title is same, types of parser, but if you see, table is there, not that diagram. Anyone could unmute or text me? Kindly acknowledge, yes, then I'll move. Okay, thank you, ma'am. Now let us move on to difference. Whatever I said, the same, but for your examination point of view, I'm going to put it in the form of table, nothing more. If you look at top-down parser, bottom-up parser, the very first point difference is it first looks at the highest level of the parse tree. Highest level means what? Root node. And works down the parse tree by using the rules of the grammar. Now, it looks at the or works at the lowest level of the parse tree, that is leaf level. Lowest means not in other way, it is in the leaf level, and works up the parser by using the rules of the grammar. Both are using rules only. Here single word expansion is happening, here single word reduction is happening. Suppose if you are not able to articulate this, if you feel difficulty in English writing, you are having freedom to write. Expansion is happening from root to the leaf, reduction is happening from leaf to the roof. That's it, more than enough, that articulation for examination point of view. Now, top-down parsing attempts to find the leftmost derivation for an input string. Here we are talking about leftmost derivation. This is the highlight point. Here when we are looking at bottom-up parser, reduce the input string to the start symbol. This is the highlight point. Whatever you like, in what order you like, you can write. Now, we start from the top or start symbol of the parse tree. We move on to the leaf node. Whatever I articulated, I am putting it in text form. That's all. Here, in this parsing technique, we start parsing from the bottom leaf node of the parse tree. We move to the top of the parse tree, that is root node. Now, next, it uses leftmost derivation. That is a point you should remember. It uses reverse of rightmost derivation. This is the point you should use. Now, its main decision is to select. Here, the main decision is to select the production rule to use in order to construct the string. Here, it uses the production tool to reduce the string to get the to obtain the start symbol. That is a major difference. In any order, you can write. But finally, I want which will expand, which will reduce. Which is LL? Here you can even write one more point. This is called LL parser. This is called LR parser. It's all up to your creativity. Here leftmost derivation is used. Here reverse of rightmost derivation is used. Here starts from the string and reaches, starts from the root or start symbol, reaches the string. It starts with the string, reaches the root node or start symbol. These are all the possible combinations you should be able to write in the examination, nothing more. That's all. Now, top-down parser we have seen. Just I have cropped that image, I have brought it here in order to discuss top-down parser exclusively. Already I addressed this in the previous slide. Now let us move on to the example of backtracking. Although theoretically we have discussed, let us see one example, walk through upon this example. There are two productions you are having. First production is S produces small x P z. P is a non-terminal. So capital P produces YW or R symbol, either R symbol, Y. Now, how this occurs, let us see. This is more technical, input buffer. The string which you want to parse is X, Y, Z. This is what the input string is fed to the machine. Upon this string, you need to do the parsing action, or your machine need to do the parsing action, so that this is loaded into the data structure called input buffer. The moment any kind of data you need to load into your computer, you must require the data structure. So one of that data structure is input buffer. Your given input string is loaded into the buffer. Now let us see. Now our objective or goal is to start with the start symbol, because we are working on the top-down parser. We need to reach this person. We need to start here. We need to reach here. Nothing more is our objective. In between, what you need to do? There are three productions given in your hand. Which production, which order, how to choose, when to choose is your logic. Nothing more you are doing here. Now let us move on to the diagram. S is the start symbol. In order to obtain the string X, Y, Z is my objective, goal. Now I am expanding. S doesn't have any other option. Single option, no non-determinism, no backtracking, no brute force is required, because I am having only one choice. So that without any confusion, I'm just expanding the start symbol by these three. X is the terminal, it becomes a leaf node. Since it is non-terminal, it becomes the intermediate node. Z is a terminal, it becomes leaf node. Now the question starts here. P need to be expanded. If I want to expand P, I have a lot of confusions. This has two production. Now, our goal is to reach with X, Y, Z. Since it has two production, another confusion, much more confusion is there, complexity. Look at this, Y is available in the prefix. This is what called left factoring. This Y is occurring in the first place. Being a compiler, our compiler looks at one symbol at a time. It cannot look further like a human. So that, let us imagine in this scenario, YW is occurring first. Just because of available very near to me, I'm replacing P by YW. Now what will happen? W is not at all available in my string. Not at all matching will happen. So naturally, I need to do backtracking. What is the meaning of backtracking is undo. We do undo, redo operation in Microsoft Word, no? Undo, redo, control Z. That all we will be doing, no? Most of the computer operations involved with undo and redo. That kind of operation we are doing. Again, we need to go up to this level of P. That P, now we are having alternate attempt. We are having another attempt, Y. Now we are trying to replace that Y. If we try to harvest all the string in the leaf node, harvesting X, Y, Z exactly matches with our objective or goal. We are succeeded. This is the manner brute force algorithm will work. But when you try to implement brute force algorithm in your computer for the compilation process, you may already deep learning algorithm responds answer for us after 1 hour, after 2 hours, after 7 hours. If this kind of compiler, if you design Python, if you are designing like this, imagine maybe after 1 year, after completion of your degree, your algorithm will stop. If that also algorithm stops with the wrong answer, what you will do? That is why brute force algorithm we should not implement when it is computerized. This is all the part called discussion or thinking perspective, theoretical perspective. Now let us move on to Could you able to understand, guys? Backtracking, very first. This is also for theory purpose. Only you should know how it works. That's it. Do you have any doubt on it? If yes, you text me. Otherwise, I proceed. Now yes, let us. Okay, ma'am. Now bottom up parser. Here also, although it is third unit, one example we are understanding the exact difference between those two. That's it. So already I have discussed. There are two major type: operator precedence, shift reduce parser. Shift operator precedence parser also part of shift reduce parser only. See, look at the arrow mark which I have given. Then this works well with ambiguity. Shift reduce parser, otherwise called LR parser. LR parser has four category: SLR, LR, LALR, canonical LR. That's all. Uses stacked data structure. Here, predictive parser also uses stacked data structure. I didn't mention. That's all. Now, this also we have seen. LLR, what is the meaning? Now, let us see. This is what our goal or objective. This is what our string. We need to parse this string. This is what our objective. In order to reach this string, we have this production, combinations of productions. Now, what is our duty is, we need to start with the start symbol. Then we need to move on with a string if it is of top-down parser. If it is bottom-up parser, look at, we are starting with the string, not with the start symbol. Understand? Then I am trying to replace this A by S. Then I am trying to replace this B by S. Then I am trying to replace S plus S by S. I am reaching towards the root from the string. If you do reverse order, then it is said to be bottom up parser. That's all. Normally in your flat subject itself, top down parser only you used to do. Bottom up parser never they will teach. This is a different paradigm. That's all. This is also a parsing action. Here reduction is happening. From the string we are moving towards the start symbol. Whereas in the previous case, from the start symbol, here you will start with the start symbol, you end with the string. That is a slight difference. Over. Now, holistic picture I have brought in you. Now we are moving on to another type, recursive descent parsing, in which nothing I'm going to tell. What it is going to do is recursively it is going to work in order to accept your input and construct the parse tree, may or may not recover backtracking. This already I mentioned during the previous slide itself. The same definition only it is given. Nothing more we are going to discuss here. Enough. Now predictive parser comes. Today I am going to introduce only theoretical aspect of predictive parser. Then I will tell you what are all the steps involved in predictive parser. It is a problem. It's a kind of problem, I can say. So next session we can address that problem in deeper so that you will not have any confusion. Today I'll introduce this theoretical point of view. Predictive parser is a kind of recursive descent parser without backtracking. That is a beauty. It involves with the state data structure or component of predictive parser. It has one input buffer. This input buffer is to meant for loading user program. A plus B, who writes? User writes. Then that buffer is ended. Your input string is ended with $. When it comes C program, you will be ending with a semicolon. No, in order to distinguish one statement from other statement, you are using semicolon, delimiter. It is like that. It is going to load one of the statement written by the user. It is going to end with $. This is one data structure. This data structure name is called input buffer. There is another data structure which is involved for the parsing action. That data structure name is stack. Stack is initially filled with $. During the parsing action, $$ matches, you are succeeded with the parsing tree. If you are not in the position to meet these two $, you are failed in parsing. Then each time stack is going to hold some set of set of symbols. What order stack holds last in first out principle, then you will be having a logic or the program or the code that is called predictive parsing program. This predictive parsing program only controls your parsing action. You need to write, if you become a compiler constructor language writer, you need to design this program. The purpose of this topic, what we are discussing theoretically, is algorithm for predictive parsing, parsing table construction. This is what every component of the program, we need to design a parse table. Then it gives the output. The major role of the predictive parsing program is to communicate with input buffer, to communicate with the parsing table, to communicate with the stack, interacting with these three data structures. Finally, it produces the output. That is the core purpose of predictive parsing table. You also will be doing with the parsing program, hands-on you will be doing. Theoretically, you will be doing when it comes to a laboratory, compiler laboratory, you will be doing program. You need to design first this parse table. Once the parse table is ready, this is what our core objective. Designing parse table is the core objective. After parse table only, you will have sample input. By the time of parsing action, you will be looking into stack also, and you will be ending with the output. So this is how the problem also works, program or program also work. This is the kind of schematic diagram to understand the working principle of predictive parser. That's it. You are going to give input, contains input to be parsed with dollar. It is a end mark. Whatever I have articulated, I'm showing in the written form. I will just read. Contains sequence of grammar symbol with dollar as its bottom marker. Initially, stack contains only dollar. Parsing table, a two-dimensional array, M means a kind of representation, matrix of, it is a matrix of set of all pair of non-terminal and terminal. You will come to know. I will be teaching you parsing table construction. This is a core part. You need to understand. Very base for third unit as well. How to design a parse table, you should understand. That parse table will be in the form of matrix. All the row will constitute a non-terminal symbol. All the column will constitute a terminal symbol. That is what two-dimensional array we are going to design. Where A is a non-terminal and small is A is the terminal. Now, important points you need to understand. It eliminates the need for recursion facility. Why we are using this predictive parser is recursion is not required. Then an overhead with this technique is explicit maintenance of stack. We need to maintain the stack. We need to bring the stack architecture also, data structure also. That is, these are all the possible drawback or pitfalls. This all we may need to note. Now, what is a predictive parser? Predictive parser uses an algorithm to parse the input string. That is what I said. It uses this algorithm and it uses the parse table and it parses the string and it recognizes or produces the output. This is the explanation given here. Now, very first step involved with this predictive parsing table is first and follow computation. This we should know. For first computation also there is an algorithm. For follow computation is also there is an algorithm. Once if we have computed first and follow, the next step is algorithm for designing the table. Now these are all the steps. This is called parse table, first and follow computation. This is called parse table. After this first and follow computation only guides and helps for parsing table construction. This is the second step. Step by step, I may need to guide you. First, I must make you to be empowered to compute first and follow. After this, I need to drive you in order to design the parse table. This is what our second step. Once if you are ready with those two, first and follow computation and parse table construction, then I need to give you one input string. Then you must use that. This is called parsing action. Step by step, it parses your input. Now finally, the string is accepted. You are reaching to the start symbol, that recognition of this. It means $. One more step I supposed to write. Same manner, I am bringing one more example. For this example, first computation, follow computation. If you are ready with that, you can go for table construction. With that table, you can go for parsing action. Then we end up with limitations. Then these are all the exercise. These all are collected from GATE question paper. If you are capable of solving these 5 questions, or I may give one more. You are mastered on first and follow computation. This is what the primary step. If your first and follow becomes right, only then this parse table becomes right. If first and follow becomes right, naturally parse table also becomes right. If parse table is valid, parsing action will become easier and valid parsing will happen. It's all interdependent. So that, let me start first and follow computation in the subsequent class. Maybe maximum of 2 hours, I'd be completing your unit number 2. Then we will move on to unit number 3. So you need to remember these are all the words. First and follow computation, predictive parse table or LL parse table construction. After the table construction, LL parsing action. You need to do the action, LL parsing, real parsing you supposed to do. These are all the possible steps involved. If I touch upon, I may not able to complete by 12:50. So that I will hold up to this point. Among these two, computing first is much easier. The moment I explain you one example itself, you would be picking up. Then follow computation, you need to put a lot of effort. You need to pay attention. If you pay attention towards my explanation, more than enough. Then once if you are good enough, then follow computation is dependent on first computation. Understand, this is a sequence. First computation helps for follow computation. Both first and follow computation helps for predictive parser table, table construction, then parsing table construction. Once the parsing table becomes right, after that this first and follow doesn't record for us. Only the set of production, this production is record for us, this production. And we would recover this parsing table. We need stack data structure. We need one input string, valid input string. Then we can work on the parsing action, step-by-step illustration. That's all. You can easily understand this. You can do here. There is no more effort for you. It is required. This table construction is also much easier. If you look at, we will be harvesting all the terminals in a given grammar. We need to arrange all the terminals in any order upon the column. In addition to all the given terminals, you need to include one special symbol dollar as well. This is a key point. All the rows you need to arrange non-terminals. That's it. Then how to fill these entries, only the question mark for you left out right now. In order to fill these entries, we must have first, we must have follow. In order to compute the follow, first helps. In order to fill the entry, both first and follow helps. That with that opening point, I will stop at this junction. Then we will continue in the next session, first and follow computation and the parse table. And shortly you will be having 1 minute, I'll stop recording.